a grim, very grim milestone. Now, in Idlib at the moment, there is a tenuous ceasefire that has been holding. There is this sense amongst many people that when the bomb humanitarian does not. And what really struck me most that trip, and I've been reporting on, stopped asking us, why doesn't the world care about what's happening? Or why is this happening to us? You just hear it all the time. And it's almost as if for the population there, they realize at this stage that it's futile. Syria has destroyed too many lives for us to begin to be able to count. It's shredded families, either through death or displacement. Hundreds of medical facilities have been targeted and hit and bombed by the Syrian government, by regime fighter jets and helicopters. The war has decimated significant parts of Syria's infrastructure and its previously functional and relatively advanced healthcare system. Almost 12 million Syrians have been forced to flee their homes, and some are displaced internally. Others are living as refugees in neighboring countries. They face incredibly precarious conditions, economic instability. In other words, they can't find work, food insecurity. In other words, they don't have enough money to put regular meals on the table. Very few Syrians who you meet who are living as refugee families in neighboring countries can actually feed their children 3 meals a day. There's also a lack of access to basic services, especially now, of course, everything has been greatly aggravated by the COVID-19 pandemic. And, you know, I often hear people say throughout the course of my reporting, viewers who are watching the stories that we put out saying it's too complicated. And they use that as if it's something of a justification to be able to turn away. And I want to thank everyone who's joining us today for not being those people, for listening, wanting to learn more about what's been happening in Syria. And I also want to thank MSF for their continued efforts to respond to the humanitarian crisis there. Now, as I was saying, in this discussion, we will be reflecting on the past 10 years, how the war has shaped and changed Syria and the lives of so many. And we'll also look beyond the terminology of war and humanitarian work and show what it really means, what it really looks like, what it really feels like. MSF and others continue to respond to the humanitarian crisis in Syria by donating medical supplies, setting up hospitals and clinics, providing remote support to medical facilities and networks of doctors in areas that cannot be directly accessed. And today we're joined by some experts who will reflect on the past 10 years of war in Syria and on MSF's response there. But before we continue, I have a little bit of housekeeping to take care of. So this discussion will run for about 90 minutes. Wherever you're joining from today, you can submit questions for our panelists. If you're watching on live stream, YouTube Live, Facebook Live, or Twitch, I don't even know what Twitch is. You can send questions in the comments or live chat section, and our team members will send them to me. We will be prioritizing questions directly related to today's discussion. And there are also live captions for this event. You can view them on a separate URL, or you can watch them on YouTube, or you can click on the button that says CC in the YouTube player to turn them on. You know, these are really good instructions. Like, this is what I would actually need to hear if I was watching this. We'll add the links to both those options in the chat. Now, onto our panelists. We have with us Dr. Chenery Lim, who's medical coordinator for MSF in Northwest Syria. Joel Razi, field coordinator for MSF in Northwest Syria. Will Turner, head of emergency operations for MSF in Northeast Syria. And Dr. Aula Abbara, consultant in infectious diseases at Imperial College in London and the co-chair of the Syria Public Health Network. Now, if you're wondering why it's split into Northwest and Northeast, it's because Syria today is not a unified country. It's actually a patchwork. You have the bulk of the territory, more or less, which is controlled at the moment by the Syrian regime, the government of Bashar al-Assad in Damascus. Then you have the Northeast, which is controlled by the Kurds. And then you have the Northwest, which is partly controlled by what remains of Syria's rebel forces, and then partly under the control of Turkey. So to start with you, Joel, as I was saying, you know, today Syria is not this one unified country, and your work is focusing in the northwest, in Idlib, that I was just talking about in my introduction. Can you share a little bit more about what the dynamics are like there and what kinds of challenges you're facing?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Arwa. Thank you, everyone, for being here. So as you were mentioning, I've been working on Idlib for the past almost 10 months. And the area of Idlib, so what we'll be mentioning as the Northwest, is today home to 3 million people. So you already have to imagine that amount. Pre-war Syria, Idlib was not one of the most populous provinces. It was maximum maybe home to 1 million people. Today, Idlib is home to 3 million people. Out of this 3 million, half of them are displaced. So we're talking about an area whose 50% of its population are displaced people living in precarious situation, living in tents for the big part. And a lot of these people is not their first displacement. You know, for a lot of us, and this is really something important we have to communicate on Idlib and on Syria broadly. Most of the people in Syria have been displaced multiple times. And the reality of Idlib and its population today is that most of the people there have been displaced 4, 5, 6, and even 7 times. A lot of these people have had to flee from the, let's say, their first place to another place where they had family, it witnessed war, and so on and so on and so on. So this story has been going on for 10 years. And the reality today is that the people in Idlib have been displaced multiple times. Half of them are displaced in Idlib. A lot of them face the wrath of nature, I would say. We witness it every year, sadly. I've been on Idlib on and off for the past 4 years. Every winter, when there is a heavy rain for 2 days, camps are flooded. There are 2 meters of water. People lose their tents, their livelihoods, whatever little they were able to flee with. So when we are talking about Syria, of course, it's quite broad. But for my part, when it comes to just Idlib, this is really the situation. It's an area that we hear about in the news on and off. So sometimes we hear about an increase in the conflict. For example, a year ago, a bit more than a year and a half ago, actually, when we heard there was a big military offensive, and this caused 1 million more displaced within Idlib. However, even if when we don't hear about Idlib, it's an area that is an active conflict. There is everyday bombing somewhere in the area that affects some part of these 3 million people. So this is the reality in really brief terms, I would say, about the area. And this is the reality of where MSF today has parts of its operations.
Yeah, and just to kind of add to your description, so when Joel's talking about people being repeatedly displaced in Idlib, a lot of the fighting lately, again, there was this ceasefire that's been in place, but it was focused on this one province. And what each military offensive did, each round of bombing did, was take this population and crush it up into an ever shrinking chunk of territory. And the thing is from this one last chunk of territory, there is nowhere for people to flee to. And that is why each time there is another bombing offensive, there is panic, because they can't cross into Turkey and they can't go back into regime areas. They're quite simply too afraid to. And now, to kind of illustrate how many times people end up fleeing, and how when you're working within the humanitarian sector and trying to set up healthcare clinics, we have this 2-minute video where we'll hear from Mustafa, who is one of MSF's health center directors. And he and his family were on the move fleeing violence from 2011 to 2016. And along the way, at every single point when they thought that they'd finally reached relative safety, he and his colleagues would try to set up makeshift medical centers along the way.
يعني أنا مثلاً بدي أحكي لك عن نفسي. أنا كنت في مدينة عنادان بال 2011. الآخر 2011 نزحنا على كفر حمراء، ومن كفر حمراء رجعنا على عنادان، بعدين رجعت نزحت على الدانة، بعدين على دار تعزي. أنا بالنسبة إلي كشخصياً يعني رجعت بعدين على تقاد وعلى عنادان، ورجعنا بالتهجير الأخير نزحنا هون على الدانة. الأماكن اللي نزحنا عليها كلها فيها عنف، بس مثلاً بدرجة أقل من المكان اللي أنا كنت فيه، لأني وقت بلش النظام يستعمل العنف صار في إصابات، ونحن ما عندنا مشافي، ما عندنا مراكز طبية، فنحن عملنا بأكثر من مكان مركز طبي مثلا إسعافي يعني قدر الإمكان لمعالجة الناس. فعملنا مركز طبي وقتها بعندان، عملنا مركز طبي بكفر حمراء. وقت اللي رجعنا نزحنا من كفر حمراء رجعنا بآخر نزوح وقت اللي انتقلنا على اتقاد من شي 3-4 سنين لأن المركز الطبي على اتقاد. طبعا نحن المراكز الطبية اللي أنشأناها بكل أوقات النزوح بكل الأماكن اللي اشتغلنا فيها يعني كانت بعمل طوعي من الأطباء اللي معنا من بعض الممرضين. طبعا كان في ندرة يعني بالممرضين بالكوادر الطبية لأن الغالبية في منهم نزحوا وفي منهم هاجروا لبرا سوريا. وعانينا طبعا كتير من موضوع قصف المنشآت الطبية. طبعا ما في يعني مكان ما في منطقة بالمناطق المحررة إلا انقصف المكان الطبي. يعني كانوا دائما يقصفوا المشفى الميداني أو النقطة الطبية ويقول لك هون في إرهابيين وهون في مقرات وهون في مسلحين. هذا الحكي كذب، النقطة الطبية معروفة، المشفى معروف، هدول الأمور كلها معروفة ومعروفة دوليا يعني أنه هون في مشفى هون في مركز طبي هون في. يعني أنا مثلا بدي أحكي لك عن نفسي، أنا كنت في مدينة عندان.
Joelle, you know, we're talking about how you're providing this remote medical support. I mean, how does that even work when people who are part of your operation on the ground are constantly on the move like this?
So that's a really big question to answer. So the point of it is that the way MSF has been working in Syria has changed depending on the situation. So in some areas where there was a relative safety, we were able to set up, let's say, proper hospitals or more regular operations. But in cases like Dr. Mustafa, who's someone who's had to move all the time, what MSF did and what we're still doing, I was myself with Dr. Mustafa on the phone last week, and is that there are doctors and medical staff among the Syrian population that are displaced that themselves take the initiative to set up a health center, field hospitals, etc. And in that case, what we try to do is we reach out to them. Actually, we've been reaching out and developing these networks for almost a decade now, and we support them. So for me, for my part, I think, I mean, I've been doing this for some years. It was quite difficult to explain this some years ago. The irony of it is that it became a bit easier last year because a lot of people have shifted to what we call remote work or work from home. This has been, in my case and several of my colleagues, our reality for 6 years. So we do Skypes, we do WhatsApp, we do calls, we get videos, we get pictures of things. I mean, it all sorts of, I mean, the way the technology evolved, we tried to evolve and use many of it. So this has been the reality of several of our MSF colleagues, and we tried as best as we can to channel support to these doctors. So, I mean, I'm not going to bore you with some of the things that I don't really know a lot about and other details. But for me, two important parts. I mean, we supported these doctors with all of the running costs of a center. We gave them medication, etc. But personally, after all these years, two things stand out. First of all, is the ability, I mean, the fact that we were able in many cases to provide some technical medical input to a lot of these doctors, because many of them, when the war started, they had to abort their studies. They couldn't finish their studies. They had to work in things they never studied even before, you know. So in many cases, they were put in situation, they were receiving wounded, there was war, and I mean, it wasn't their specialty. So the ability to speak to an experienced surgeon, even remotely, was very helpful. For me, this is the first part. The second part is that, as you saw, a lot of them, even if they, I mean, I don't like to see them because that's not the way I view it, as also victims of this war, because they have been, despite being victims, they're also providers of services and of relief. And the ability, I mean, the fact that we were talking with them and just sometimes, honestly, no amount of training or things we can do can prepare us. But sometimes we're just being there for them, just talking to them, asking them about their families. Sometimes they're talking to us, asking us about things, and we'd stay until the dead of night. And for me, these are the two things I remember when we were talking about remote support, MSF supporting facilities. Yes, it's all of the package, but it's the technical support to doctors who need it. And it's also a certain show of solidarity. of humanity and of just being there with a certain person who's your colleague, even remotely, if you've never seen him or her, but you're just chatting. They have a way of also expressing, talking about some things. So I'm not sure I answered your question.
It creates a special kind of bond. I mean, one that's really hard to put into words. And, you know, to highlight your point of this technical support that you're talking about, you know, I remember reporting on a story where an ophthalmologist was trying to do a complicated brain surgery to save somebody's life, and literally had Skyped in on his phone to an expert who was guiding his scalpel as best as he could where the electricity was out. So another colleague of theirs was holding up his cell phone to shine a little bit of light from the cell phone camera. I mean, when we think about what, you know, the medical staff inside have had to go through, I mean, it's extraordinary. And so speaking about, you know, Syria and how every region right now today is quite different. If we move on to the Northeast, so the Northeast is an area that is predominantly controlled by Syria's Kurds. It's an area that did not necessarily see that much fighting by the regime, but it's an area whose fighters, who are the Kurdish fighting force known as the YPG, ended up being the bulk of the force that ended up pushing ISIS out of certain areas in Syria that they controlled, backed, of course, by the US and other coalition allies. And so, Will, you're the emergency coordinator in this area. How do you describe kind of what your work there looks like? And obviously, it's quite different to the dynamics in the Northwest.
Yeah, thanks. On the one hand, yes, it is quite different because of the political dynamic and the presence of different armed actors there. But in terms of the humanitarian impact, I think you can draw parallels with the situation across the country, and particularly the Northwest, with the population suffering from this decade of turmoil, and that has gone through various phases, from the early phase of the uprising and the escalation of conflict, with then huge numbers of people moving out of the country, being displaced, separated from their families, trying to seek shelter, and really then MSF trying to scale up massively our activities to try and respond to the needs both inside Syria but also in neighboring countries such as Turkey, Lebanon, Iraq, Jordan, and then of course further afield in Europe as huge numbers were risking their lives trying to reach safety, including crossing the Mediterranean and Eastern Europe. And then during the next phase of very intense and heavy conflict, of course, hundreds of thousands of people lost their lives, were severely injured, and with very little ability to seek safety, all the more hampered when borders started to close from 2015 onwards, when particularly the Turkey border, which had provided a safe haven for many Syrians, over 3 million, to that option then started to become unviable, and as you said earlier, people are now being trapped. There's always been huge limitations in the amount of humanitarian support and medical assistance. There was already a weak infrastructure in the country. Many health facilities and the medical mission was targeted by armed actors, so people were not able to access healthcare safely. Many health facilities were destroyed, and many staff, including healthcare workers in MSF-supported facilities, lost their lives, particularly in 2015, when 23 MSF-supported staff lost their lives tragically. But this has been a trend that we've seen throughout the conflict. There's these different phases of crisis after the other, and now in the latter years, the years of hardship just continue with their economic situation being particularly difficult. People are becoming more food insecure. We have colleagues and patients who are, you know, having two meals a day rather than three. And then put on top of that the COVID pandemic in the Northeast. There's a drought which is impacting on water availability, the possibility for agriculture to take place, etc. So and what you see is that people are going through these phases of crises and each time just facing yet more uncertainty about what the future holds and often a sense of hopelessness about the future.
And you know, obviously, Dr. Chen, you know, the medical needs are wide and diverse, but in terms of what you're actually seeing with patients that you're seeing, what is the biggest challenge that they're facing today versus, say, for example, what they were facing when the fighting was at its most intense?
Yeah. So, you know, when you ask me this question, it's a little bit, to me, a little bit tricky because I don't know how do I start to explain a little bit the complexity of what is happening. If you listen to what Joel was saying, if you listen to what Will is saying, the conflict never stopped. This is an area wherein it's a protracted conflict. That means the conflict is happening all the time. And if you look at it, if you translate it to health, it's a little bit also that health is also multifactorial. It's cause and effect. Conflict is happening. We don't hear it in the news. It doesn't mean it's not happening. Our facility is receiving trauma patients, for example, every week. We are still seeing this, but it's not being highlighted, you know? As what Joel is saying, we actually have to monitor health scenarios by season because it's so different that our response also has to be adaptable to what is happening per season. So for example, this winter, it was the harshest winter that the northern part of Syria actually experienced, wherein we had to really run after, you know, building, you know, improvising the tent for the people, to make sure that they have enough warm clothes, because then we will see that now again an increased rise in frostbite, you know, increased rise in hypothermia. This summer, for example, our team is preparing for heat stroke, for example, because of the lack of access to, you know, water. You're talking about basic needs. You know, you're talking about access to clean drinking water, wherein these are things that is supposed to be free, you know. These are things that is supposed to be given to you for free, and it's not free inside. So it's a little bit of this basic health care that is actually not there. But sometimes we also forget, because the thing is that when you talk about health, people only think about the physical one, because it's something that we see. So it's something that is like, okay, you are hurt, that's there. You're in pain. But what you don't see is actually the not physical one that actually people are suffering. I can talk about this if I look at it in from our staff. As you mentioned before, these people has been displaced multiple times. Our staff, our healthcare service providers, are also victims of this displacement. Our healthcare providers every day go to our hospital serving their own people. The resiliency of our staff in treating all of these children, for example, coming into our facility, suffering from minor illnesses, for example, and you actually don't really see and you don't really feel, but they are also victims themselves. For them to actually provide these services to our beneficiaries is already, you know, very, very good. You know, like I cannot say that the resiliency of these people is really admirable. Yeah. So definitely for me, basic access to healthcare is definitely the number one that we always need to think about. This area relies a lot on humanitarian assistance. Northwest as an area is stateless. There's no government. There's no proper health department that takes care of its people. These people rely on humanitarian assistance from us, from people. So definitely for me, it's very important that we continue to support, because as I said, it's a protracted conflict. I definitely would advocate for, you know, the renewal of this UN resolution cross-border, for because it affects, it will affect a lot of the lives of these people inside. Thank you.
You know, a lot of people might not know what this UN resolution is and what the holdup is. Arla, if you could actually address that and clarify it a little bit, and also talk about how important it is for these humanitarian corridors to remain open. Because again, as you know, we've all kind of highlighted, the bombs might not be falling in the same intensity as they were before, but that does not mean that the need has decreased.
Cool, thank you very much. And thank you very much to my colleagues for highlighting some of the issues across the country. So the UN Security Resolution on cross-border aid is actually really pertinent at the moment because it's up for renewal in July. So the background to this resolution was that early in the conflict, the provision of healthcare and humanitarian aid was criminalized by the Syrian government. So there are many Syrian healthcare workers that have been imprisoned, tortured, or forced to flee as a direct result of this criminalization of healthcare for people considered to be opposing the Syrian government. And this has affected thousands of healthcare workers and has been a big driver of the exodus of healthcare workers that we have seen through no fault of their own. And so what happened with international pressure, and this was a positive step, was that in 2014, the first UN Security Resolution Council resolution on cross-border aid was established, and it allowed for four humanitarian corridors, so four borders. So two in the northwest, so Bab al-Hawa and Bab al-Salama, one in the south, and one in the northeast, and Yarubiya border crossing. And this was always, and this what this allowed was humanitarian actors based whether they be in Jordan, Turkey, or elsewhere, to be able to support the health and humanitarian provision in areas mostly outside of government control. The reason this was essential is because very early on it became clear that the flow of aid through the government was not going to reach everyone equitably across all areas based on humanitarian need, not based on political affiliation or corruption or anything else that could occur. Every year it was up for annual renewal, and this was always a very tense time for all the humanitarian organisations, including Medicines on the Frontier, but many of the Syrian organisations that are providing humanitarian care in the northwest, the northeast, and then previously in the south of the country before it was taken over by the Syrian government. Of course, Eastern Ghouta, so Damascus suburbs as well, before it was taken by the Syrian government. What happened in January 2020 was devastating. There was the closure of Yarubiya border crossing, which served the northeast of the country. So when we hear from Will and the rest of the team about the situation in the northeast, just before a pandemic, it's had devastating consequences in terms of the ability to respond not only to the normal health and humanitarian needs in that area, which are dire. So that area, if you remember, was already underserved before the onset of the Syrian conflict. It was neglected. It didn't have the same investment as Damascus, Aleppo, and elsewhere. And so that happened in the northeast. And what became very clear when provisions were provided to the Syrian government to respond to COVID, whether it be training, PCR machines, PPE, anything else that would support the health system in the northeast, it simply wasn't reaching the people that needed it in the northeast in the way that it was intended by the international community. This has been devastating to the northeast. But if we now go to the northwest, where, depending on how you define the northwest, there's about 4.17 million people, and that includes the areas under Turkish control. And as we heard from Joel, these are people living between the closed Turkish border on one side, the lines between opposition control and government control on the other side, the closure of Bab al-Salama hospital last year. And in July, there is very high threat that Bab al-Hawa border crossing is going to be closed. And this is going to cut off more than 4 million people. And we heard more than 50 to 75% of those people are already internally displaced. Many of the IDPs themselves are women and children. That's more than 70-80% are women and children. And they have very high humanitarian needs. We're seeing all the normal things, diarrheal infections, uncontrolled cases of COVID-19, but also severe acute malnutrition, which in Syria before the conflict wasn't something that we were seeing. And that's notwithstanding those who have been affected by the conflict. The elderly, those with non-communicable diseases, those with chronic conditions, and of course, those with disabilities. We don't know the number of disabled people in Syria. We estimate, I've heard everything from 1 million to 2 million, but we're talking vast numbers of people whose lives have been devastated by the conflict. And so that's why I ask everyone, I think, who's listening to this call to really advocate that, and all the humanitarian actors, in any way that we can, we must be advocating for Bab al-Hawa border crossing to remain open. The consequences, should it close, are going to be devastating. In a country in conflict where we've seen the worst of the humanitarian crises in our generation, I can't believe I'm saying this, but it could even be worse than we could possibly imagine if it weren't renewed.
And this is very much, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it is the politicization and the weaponization of humanitarian assistance with little to no regard for the people, the civilians that will be impacted by it.
Absolutely. That's very nicely said, Arwa. So I was reflecting on this earlier, and it's a very, I'm Syrian, albeit with the privileges of someone who's grown up in the UK. And it's very clear for me that very few people who have power in Syria, and I'm going to use that broadly across the country, care very much for civilians in any part of the country. I do think, however, it's important to highlight that when we look at the balance of morbidity, mortality, attacks on healthcare workers. So I'm sure everyone is aware that more than 930 healthcare workers have been killed in this conflict in the last few years. More than 500,000 people have been killed in this conflict. Of a pre-war population of around 21 million. So these are devastating numbers, but more than 90% have been by the Syrian government. And so for me, it's always been very difficult when I talk to international actors and they say, but aid must flow through the Syrian government. We must work with the Syrian government so that aid, they can equitably provide aid across the country. Whereas in fact, we know that's not the case. There's been some excellent work from Human Rights Watch, Physicians for Human Rights and others, where they examine the situation, for example, for returnees. So people who may have been displaced once again and have to go back to certain areas, they don't get the same level of healthcare access. And actually, now we're talking about COVID-19. If we look at vaccination, I'd be very surprised if they had the same access to vaccination or any other services. Water is an important one. I really liked what Chen said about, I'm a clinician and Chen's a clinician. We tend to think of health in a one-dimensional way, but health is about everything. It's about water and wash infrastructure, which in itself has been weaponized. And we know that from a Luke water station in the northeast, which has often deprived 400,000 to 500,000 already desperate people of water in this political interplay that has occurred through the conflict, leaving children, other vulnerable people at risk of death and suffering from entirely treatable conditions. So in our whole camp, it's not infrequent that we hear of children that have died of diarrheal illnesses, when of course, water, healthcare should be a human right.
And I think that probably among one of the more disturbing causes of death within this context. I mean, all causes of death are disturbing, but these kinds of illnesses that are so treatable and yet end up devastating so many families that are already dealing with these compounded traumas. I just want to also briefly remind everybody who's watching that you can submit your questions to the panel in the chat on the various mediums that you are watching on. And to that effect, we do have some questions that are beginning to come in. And this one is quite appropriate on the heels of what we were talking about, given that, you know, Syria has been a war zone without a front line and without rules. And so, Joelle, I'll send this your way first. This is from Cole on Instagram. Thank you, Cole. What precautions does MSF take when working in countries that are at war?
Well, it's a broad question, but if we bring it back specifically to Syria, in terms of precautions, I think the risk analysis from the beginning has been a risk of bombing. This, I think a lot of our colleagues just talked about it, but when if I'm asked about Syria, what's the biggest plight also that health workers have faced is air bombings. It's not the only one, it's far from being the only one, but that's the biggest one. So in terms of precautions, in many cases, I mean, we've had to support facilities were underground, -2, -3, people have had to dig other parts of the building that were above ground, we had to fill them with sandbags. I mean, people tried everything. In our case, this is why I think it's important also to be honest. In our case, we say MSF managed facilities and MSF supported facilities, and it's not the same thing. When we say managed facility, we mostly try to place these facilities close to the border because we think it's safe from bombing to some extent. When we say we supported facilities, these are facilities set up by Syrians for Syrians in their towns. And in that case, we try to recommend some things, but at the end of the day, they will set up their facility. And a lot of them are not with us anymore, sad to say, but they tried as best as they could. And at the end of the day, there's no amount of sufficient protection you can do when there's so much sophisticated weaponry being used.
And I think it's worth, you know, reminding everyone who's watching right now that medical facilities were often hit at times deliberately targeted by both the Syrian regime and the Russians. And this is despite the fact that, you know, at one point in time, the coordinates of some of these locations were shared with the United Nations, intending to keep them safe, and yet they were bombed anyways. Providing medical assistance in areas that were under rebel control was considered to be a crime. And a lot of these clinics that we talk about, a lot of these medical facilities that we talk about, they were actually underground. They were hidden in secret locations. You could not disclose where they were. For us as the media, oftentimes when we went to try to film there, we were told, you know, no, it's just too risky. And, you know, we completely respect that. Or we would have to, you know, go in and then only film once we were inside the facility. And it's kind of mind-blowing to think that just trying to save someone's life would make you a target. But that was just the reality of what people there were facing. And, you know, to that effect, Joel, I wanted to ask you another question that might be a bit difficult, but how many of the doctors and medical staff who you've known over the years working in Syria are still with us?
I mean, I don't have the broader numbers for all the country. I can only talk about the few or the ones that in the project, in my experience, you worked with.
Yeah.
I think I tried to forget the exact number, but if I... memory serves well, maybe a third or 40% of, and again, this is my case, I mean, the teams and the smaller projects I was in, around 40% of the medical staff in general, so we're talking doctors, nurses, pharmacists, and so on, technicians, are not with us today anymore. And I have covered around 6 years and a half of work with MSF on Syria, and during those 6 years, a good 30 to 40% of the staff we've supported are not with us anymore today, if memory serves right again.
I'm sorry, it's hard, but it is sadly the reality for Syria. I remember, you know, the beginning of, you know, the revolution and the demonstrations, you know, as the media, we would all have our list of activists we were in touch with different parts of the country, and then as this wore on, that list just got shorter and shorter and shorter as people either died or they were disappeared into detention facilities. And so every aspect of working in this environment is very difficult. Will, how do you handle some of the challenges? I mean, I imagine it must be quite difficult to have operations staff located on the other side of a border. And what are some of the challenges you're facing right now in providing cross-border aid?
Well, there's quite a few challenges, but I think what keeps me up at night is the fact that in Syria for MSF is that we have not been able to negotiate access with all actors, and namely the Syrian government, to be able to work in all areas of the country to respond to the needs of the population across the country. So we have been working predominantly in the northwest and in the northeast and other opposition held areas during the evolution of the conflict. With that, our teams and medical and humanitarian staff are at risk of being seen as working for a terrorist organization in the eyes of the government, and therefore the risks that might entail for them in the future are quite considerable. And that is a challenge that our teams have to live with. And of course, our teams have family members across the country. They might need to travel to government-held areas to seek healthcare. For example, there is the need to travel to Damascus, for example, to try and receive some specialist care, because specialist care, cancer treatment, for example, is just not available in large parts of the country. And then that becomes a significant barrier, because in crossing lines into government held areas, they might get detained and questioned, and that could have severe consequences for them in the future. So this is a reality now and also for the future. So our teams are taking great risks as well to provide assistance to their community. And we as MSF want to stand in solidarity with them and the population. And that's why we tried to find different ways as MSF throughout this conflict to continue to provide assistance when we weren't able to access areas because we weren't able to negotiate with certain armed groups, or that we felt it was too insecure. Then we try to find ways to support by providing medical supplies and financial support to pay for salaries to allow Syrian healthcare workers to continue to provide assistance to their community. And then as the conditions have, let's say, improved and somewhat allowed MSF to work inside the country. For example, in the northeast, we are able to run full medical activities in certain parts. But it is incredibly difficult environment, because our staff are living through the crisis as well, and we also have to support and be compassionate to them. And just want to share a story of actually a colleague and a close colleague of mine who works with us in Amsterdam, a Syrian colleague, just to highlight a bit the indirect tragedy of the impact of the Syrian war. So he actually left Syria when the conflict started, soon after the uprising, and actually started to work in Turkey with MSF. During that time, it became very difficult for him to continue to support his family, and his grandfather was unable to receive cancer treatment anymore because the border closed with Turkey, and his grandfather and grandmother both died. He eventually came to the Netherlands and was able to start working with us in the Netherlands, and in 2018 his father was at home and working on the roof and tragically fell off the roof and landed on his head and severe brain injury. Now, this was in the northeast in a place called Commissley, and there was, despite their best attempts to try and access a health facility, there was just no health facility that could take care of his father. They were driving from one facility to the other, and there was no bed space. Eventually, they found a private facility where they managed to pay to get a bed after several hours of driving around in the back of a vehicle. After a day or two, a bed became available, unfortunately, when somebody else came and to try and receive some adequate healthcare. In the end, that was not enough, and sadly, he died. And it's this kind of situation that is so tragic that Syrians are living through many different aspects of a difficult situation, and being separated from loved ones, not being able to provide support, not being able to travel to see family, and the lack of basic healthcare and services, which is having such a devastating impact on people's lives.
Yeah, I think and thank you for sharing that story. I think a lot of people, when they hear about, you know, humanitarian and medical assistance in conflict zones, they just think response to violence, which of course is a big part of it, but then it's also all of these other aspects of healthcare and how, you know, when the medical infrastructure gets decimated, it's not just then about being unable to provide for people that need emergency treatment because they've been injured in violence. It's also being able to provide these kinds of basic services just to save people's lives. And we have another question, which kind of relates to this. This is from Kieran on Instagram. And Dr. Chen, maybe you can address this. How has the medical work in Syria changed over this 10-year period?
So how did it change? So I think, you know, this war started, as you said, a lot of it started as an emergency wherein, you know, you always respond.
I think we might be having some audio problems. With Dr. Chen's audio. Sorry, we seem to have lost Dr. Chen's audio. Well, I mean, it's not a Zoom discussion if something doesn't go wrong. So hopefully, Dr. Chen, we can figure out how to get your audio back, and then we'll return to that question. Meanwhile, I have another one from Julia, who's watching on live stream. Arla, maybe you can answer this one. Has there been any research done into building bomb-resistant health centers in Syria?
That's a very interesting question. So I wouldn't describe it as research, but and it ties into what Chen was just speaking, was addressing. What's been devastating about this conflict is actually hospitals are among the most dangerous places for people to be. So people might be dreadfully unwell, but doctors will try and turn them around really quickly and discharge them before they're perhaps ready. Patients don't like going to hospitals. They avoid them at all costs. And that's because, like Arwa was saying, the deconfliction mechanism, so the mechanism by which the coordinates of hospitals and healthcare facilities were shared with the international community, quite possibly led directly to them being targeted. And so as a result of this, over the last few years, increasingly health facilities have been built underground, and pretty much all health facilities, especially the ones that were existing or built new, were being reinforced. So you'll have heard of some of the underground or cave hospitals. If anyone's not watched the phenomenal film called The Cave, starring Amani Ballour, which was up for an Oscar nomination, I think it was early this year or last year, you must watch it, because she quite beautifully shows us how devastating it is to run a hospital underground. She was working in Reef, Damascus suburb, so Reef Dimashq, in those areas. So in terms of actual research about it, I'm happy for my colleagues to correct me. I don't think there has been. But in terms of the humanitarian practice, particularly by a number of the Syrian humanitarian organizations, the Syrian American Medical Society being one of them, there's been reinforcement and changes in the way we structure our health facilities and reinforce them, which is a dreadfully sad thing to say, and certainly not something that we should ever accept to be normal.
No, it's not. And it's kind of been this, you know, whole effort of how far underground can we go? And then the bombs that fall get bigger and more powerful. I think we have Dr. Chen back now. Sorry Hello. That we lost you earlier.
Yeah, I'm really sorry about that.
It happens. You're in Beirut, and electricity and internet are spotty at best. I can attest to that myself. But on a more serious note, we were talking about how you'd sort of seen the Syrian medical landscape changing over the last 10 years.
Yeah. So basically, I mean, from what I saw during the last couple of years is that a lot of this change from, you know, a lot of the emergency mode to being a more of a slightly stable one. And it's, as I said, that it's very adaptable to the needs of our beneficiaries also. So sometimes we adapt on, for example, having a mobile clinic that is providing primary healthcare services, to being having a facility that only serves, for example, maternal and child health services, because that is what is needed in the area. So for example, if I look at it on the facility that we are co-managing now, we are the only one that is providing a comprehensive emergency maternal obstetric and newborn care. So that means we're the only one that's providing cesarean section to a population of more than 200,000 people. So imagine that every day, this is the only thing that our physicians and our doctors are doing. So it's a little bit of this adaptation to the needs of what we actually are seeing on the ground. So this is how it's evolving now, because now we have to respond to the specific needs of the population. This is like what Ola is saying and Joel is saying, is that majority of the people there are women and children. A lot of the men we lost during the conflict. And now with this economic crisis, we are also seeing a lot more of underage pregnancy. So these are things now that we are trying to focus on a lot.
If you'll allow me, sorry.
Oh yeah, of course. Jump right
if
in.
I can just jump on part of this question on the evolution of healthcare. I think one important point is the fragmentation of it. And the doctors can correct me if I'm wrong, but what we saw is with the heightened insecurity, you know, when we're talking about a hospital, most people imagine a hospital. So you have several departments, you have different wings and everything. What we have had in many areas of Syria, Damascus, the south, and today the north, is that services were divided. So basically what people understand as being a hospital today in Syria is actually five different places and five different locations, and each has a different specialty. This has caused a lot of problems in terms of management of coordination and also issues for the patients. In many cases, patients needed different types of specialties or service, and this is not what we have today. Because of insecurity, what Syrian doctors, for the big part, decided to do is to just separate and basically not to put all the eggs in the same basket for fear of bombing as well. So this has increased a lot in the past 10 years.
Yeah, and I think this is a little bit the adaptability of what we are seeing in a lot of the health services. Huh? I think it has to do in partly on the insecurity that you are seeing, but also partly on what is really the actual needs that the people have. You know, of course, as much as you can, you wanted to provide all the necessary services, but in some cases, it's also not just possible because then the human resource is sometimes a problem, or you know, you sometimes the materials you need to make sure that it's spread evenly to everybody. So it's this adaptability that we have to be a bit aware of. Yeah.
Well, there's been a lot of adaptation throughout the course of the last 10 years, that's for sure. We have another question from Lynn, who's watching on live stream. And Arla, maybe you can answer this one. There have been multiple calls to end sanctions. How are sanctions affecting the civilian population?
That's a very difficult and loaded question. I'm going to say the honest answer is we probably don't know. I know that there are now people looking into it because we need facts. Obviously, sanctions are an emotive issue. And depending on who you speak to, you're going to get a different opinion as to how much sanctions are affecting the population. I would urge caution in some of the messaging that's coming out. If you listen to the Syrian government and those that work closely with the government, they'll say that sanctions are affecting the Syrian government's ability to support the COVID-19 pandemic and support health and humanitarian care. But I would say we need to tread very carefully of that narrative. And the reason is sanctions are there with the exception. So things relating to health and humanitarian care should not, and I can't say for certain are not, but they should not be sanctioned. So anything that's needed for healthcare needs to come into the country and should be able to do so. In terms of what is it that's making the health and humanitarian care across the country? So Arwa, I think you alluded to this, more than 80% of Syria's population are living in poverty, and I'm going to call it abject poverty because the COVID-19 pandemic has devastated the economy. What happened in Lebanon with the Beirut blast has had an adverse effect on the Syrian economy as well, and its effects and the collapse of the Lebanese economy in terms of the impact on the banking infrastructure and all these things that I don't understand because I'm a clinician, has had a negative impact on the average Syrian civilian inside the country who's just trying to survive, make a living and have enough food on the table for their children. So do I think sanctions are the reason that health and humanitarian care across Syria, but particularly in the northeast and the northwest and some other areas of deprivation, do I think sanctions are the reason that's the case? I think we'd be very hard pushed to say that for certain, while we ignore, as you quite nicely described it, it's the weaponization of health and humanitarian care, the politicization of the provision for the everyday needs of the civilians in Syria.
And to follow up, actually, Lynn has another question, which I think leads on quite nicely, but it's a bit of a tricky one. The Syrian government now controls over 3/4 of Syrian territory. What is the condition of healthcare in these areas? And I can just say from a journalism perspective and a journalist perspective, it is extraordinarily difficult for us to get accurate, verified information from areas under regime control. The government rarely, if ever, responds to any of our queries. And a lot of people who we talk to in these areas are terrified of speaking out, even if it is about the conditions. But the snippets that we've heard are of life getting significantly more difficult, with hospitals really beginning to feel the strain of, you know, the COVID-19 pandemic, with the economy receiving multiple blow after blow, people having to queue up for bread and fuel. I'm going to just throw this out there to all of you, if any of you have any insights on what's happening in regime areas.
May I just add to this, because I've still got some family there, and in the last few months, we've had a number of deaths, both from COVID and from other conditions, in areas that are now under government control, including a cousin who's my age, who's got metastatic breast cancer. And when I'm trying to support her, she's got young children, and try and talk about what she needs. She lives, I'm not going to give many details actually, she lives in one particular area and has to travel, bearing in mind this is a dreadfully unwell lady with metastatic cancer, for 2 hours each way for every appointment. And much as we've discussed just before, so she might need to go to an oncologist and then to her surgeon, then to get some blood tests, then to get x-rays. And this is a lady who's having to travel across the country. For women, it is actually possible to travel in some ways across the country. But as we know, for men, particularly young men, that puts them at great risk. In terms of healthcare in areas under government control, I think it's always important for us who might be more familiar with the Northeast or the Northwest to be reminded just how awful the conditions are in areas under government control. The COVID-19 pandemic has shown us exactly how awful. The cases of COVID-19 started in government areas before they did in the Northwest and the Northeast, and were out of control. So we don't know the exact numbers because there was vast under-testing, under-reporting, and threats against healthcare workers for daring to say, we're seeing all these patients with COVID-19. As an aside, for healthcare workers themselves, their salaries might be $200 or $300, which is simply not enough to live. So they're doing more than one job to make ends meet. And that's a fantastic way for them to go, other than devastating for them personally. It's a very good way to transmit COVID-19 among patients when you don't have enough PPE or IPC. We don't know exactly how many Syrian doctors in areas under government control have died from what we presume are COVID-19, but we're talking dozens of doctors in a country where we already don't have enough doctors across all areas of Syria, particularly in some parts. Specialist services are adversely affected. Hospitals themselves are under-resourced, not just in terms of staff, but also in terms of simple things that we might take for granted as we respond to a pandemic. And the hospitals themselves, so if you're a Syrian with COVID-19, and I've spoken to friends with relatives who had COVID-19 in these areas, and they just did not want to go to hospital, because you might go there, there may not be enough oxygen, there may not be enough treatment, and actually transmission within these hospitals, can't say for certain, but we're presuming to be very high, with insufficient access to different medical treatments, but also higher specialty care, so things like intensive care, should you need it. I'm going to stop there, and I'm sure Joel will have more insights as well about the areas under government control.
Will, Joel, did either of you want to jump in on that one?
Well, to be honest with you, I think that there's an important point to clarify. We've been, from my side, Dr. Chen, and we're talking a lot about the Northwest and the Northeast, because this is where MSF's operations have been taking place since in the past 10 years. And we do not currently have any operations on the government side, but it's not for a lack of trying. You talked about how difficult it is for journalists to get permission. What I can tell you from several colleagues of mine that I know is that MSF has been also trying to get a registration since 2012 from Damascus, and it has been, since 2012, refused. So today, some people might look and say, okay, MSF, why are you not talking about what's happening in government area? What's the situation there? Simply because we don't have operations there. We talk, from my part, for Will, for Dr. Chen, others of our colleagues, about areas where we work, where we have projects, where we have worked. In the past 10 years, all of our attempts have been unsuccessful in registering with Damascus, and hence we have been unable to work on that side. I have some information about how the situation is there, but this is more of a personal thing, because I'm also from Damascus and I still have some family, like Dr. Aula. But from the MSF side, this is the reality, sadly, and it's not for a lack of trying. I'm not a doctor, I don't have a medical background, so I cannot be as precise as Dr. Ella, but I mean, everything what she said is true. I have received information that a lot of doctors are threatened just and are forbidden to just mention COVID. And even some of the people I know and the staff that work in hospitals, in at the onset of the pandemic, were prevented to even wear masks because this was like, this would spread panic. At least that's what they were told. And I mean, just receiving this kind of information from people you know is it's hard to believe. How can you ask doctors to go to hospitals not to wear a mask because they shouldn't spread panic? This is, anyways. The last point I think that adds on healthcare and is essential because it has affected the government areas, the northeast, the northeast and the northwest, is that in the past year alone, Syria has witnessed an economic crisis like never before. The pound has crumbled to an extent in 1 year more than it did in the past nine years. What we saw in the past, let's say, 14 months is worse than what happened since between 2011 and 19. In terms of purchasing power of people, in terms of what their salary allows them to buy. And this affects greatly healthcare because people start prioritizing things differently. Like, okay, or for example, the grandfather in a family will say, don't get this medication for me, get food for the children. I've heard people say that. I've heard people who were forced to make these choices. So when we're talking about healthcare, we cannot forego the economic crisis that has hit all of the country in the past year. So I'll leave it at that because other than that, I'll be talking about things I don't understand a lot either.
You know, Syria is not for a lack of complex problems. And there is one of these problems that I actually am quite interested to hear all of your thoughts on and have our viewers listen about. Because I think this is one of the most perhaps unique and controversial places on earth. And it's a camp that's called Al-Fol that is in the country's northeast. And basically, to sum it up, Al-Fol is mostly made up of women and children. And these are what we refer to as the last families of the caliphate. So as the last battles were happening against the Islamic State, the last batch of women and children and a couple of men to flee from there were literally rounded up and placed in this camp. And I'm very loosely calling it a camp because it's much more like an open air prison. And to go there in many ways is to sort of step into a mini version of the caliphate, but one that is being run by women. And I don't say that to mean that everybody there actually believes in the ideology of the Islamic State. Actually, most of them do not. But it is so lawless and so neglected that the women who came out of ISIS's last territory, who were the true believers, have managed to implement a version of that inside this area. Will, I mean, I've covered it, but you obviously know it a lot better than I do. Can you talk a bit about the situation in Al-Fol and what kind of services you're providing to this population? And also why it's so important that these people who are there not be rejected and ignored?
Yeah, thanks. I think Al-Hol camp represents a stain on the global conscience. And the reason for that is, as you said, at the end of 2018 and the beginning of 2019, you know, tens of thousands of women and children were bussed up to Al-Hol camp in horrendous conditions. I mean, in the back of trucks, people were dying in the back of trucks as they were traveling up and arrived in a complete chaos at Al-Hol camp. Now, the conditions in the camp have been dire since the beginning. There have been gradual improvements in some areas, but still today there's significant issues with the provision of healthcare. There's a lack of access to services. People who need specialized care are unable to receive that. the water and sanitation situation is awful. I mean, you walk around the camp and there's open sewage flowing around and small children playing in the dirt and it's not a safe environment for children. And as you said, that's two-thirds of that camp is made up of children. Now the tragedy aside, the actual conditions in that camp, the unsafe conditions, is the fact that there is no hope for those people, those children, for the future. There's very little interest or seeming motivation of the authorities and the countries who have their citizens in that camp. And just to mention that there's in an area of that camp, there's up to 10,000 foreign nationals being held in even more securized area of the camp, where people have even less access to healthcare and are held in even more constrained conditions. And they are made up from dozens of countries around the world. Countries are not taking their responsibility to find long-term solutions for them. People are languishing in this camp, and it's very uncertain what the future holds. But just to bring it back to the impact of the conditions of the camp, I mean, what that actually means is, for example, you might have a mother who brings a patient to one of our facilities. We had recently a three-year-old boy who, as so commonly in camp settings, was injured after a fuel burner got knocked over and he got severe burns. This happened at nighttime. Because there's no possibility of having health care available in the annex at night, the mother had to wait all through the night without any health care and was waiting at 8 a.m. for when our teams arrived to be able to receive medical care. We provided immediate medical care. The child needed to be referred to a specialist facility, to a burns unit. Well, there isn't a burns unit in Northeast Syria, of course, but we were able to negotiate, and you have to negotiate with the security actor, a non-medical security actor, for a patient to be referred out of the camp. So the child is referred to Hasaka National Hospital, where they have limited capacity to deal with such a case. The mother is not allowed to travel with her boy, as so often is the case. The caretaker or the mother is not allowed to be with the patient. They don't hear anything back. The mother comes to us to try and get information. We try to find out. Days later, we get in touch with the hospital, and tragically, the child died. Then, because of the securized nature of the camp, the boy was not able to come back to the camp to be at least reunited with the mother for a funeral, and the boy had to be buried with the mother, never getting to say her farewells or be present. And the boy was buried in a nearby undefined town. And this is just one example, just to highlight the horrendous situation that faced the population of that camp, and the severe limitations of people's ability to receive adequate healthcare and be treated in a dignified and humane way.
That's a horrible, horrible story, but I'm glad. Thank you for sharing it, because I think, you know, we need to hear all of this, and we can't shy or turn away from what's really happening in these situations. And to speak just a bit more about Al-Fod and you talking about it being, you know, a dark stain, I mean, the situation in the camp there is, to put it a bit more bluntly, that none of the countries who have foreign nationals there want to reclaim their foreign nationals, because they claim that they might potentially be of concern to their own national security. And so instead, they prefer to keep them dumped inside Syria in these horrendous conditions. And then you also have the bulk of the camp, which is mostly Syrians and Iraqis, many of whom are not being released to go back to wherever it is that they're originally from, many of whom actually ended up dragged into the caliphate and do not hold these fundamentalist beliefs. And what's especially important for people to also recognize is that the longer these conditions are allowed to fester, the more hatred is going to grow. And that is not the children's fault, because all they're seeing in that camp is the fact that they've been completely discarded, sidelined, don't have access to a proper education, live in these decrepit situations. And so who is going to step in and actually change the narrative and the balance of their psyche? Which actually kind of leads me to something else that is well worth talking about that another of the viewers brought up, and that's mental health. So Dr. Chen, this is from Brenda on live stream. To what extent and in what ways is MSF addressing the mental health needs of Syrian refugees, and what are the major challenges in meeting those needs?
So for us in our facility now, so we started to have mental health activities. So what we are doing is we do it like two phases. Wherein one, we have what we call the psychosocial support system, wherein we do psychosocial education more on life skills, resiliency, adaptability, and all of this. And then we have a small cohort wherein we treat a little bit more on this post-traumatic stress disorder, you know, the depression, the anxiety, and all of this. Because mental health as a topic is very wide and very varied in its sense. Huh? So you're talking about, for example, what Will was saying a little bit. So this is a little bit the case that we are seeing. You know, imagine when we were children, when you want to draw a house, you always have two shapes. It's a triangle and it's a square, you know? If you look at it in the psyche of a child inside Syria living in IDP camps, you only see always one shape, and that is a triangle. When we were drawing a house before, you always have trees, you always have, you know, these clouds, whatever, you put the windows. This the thing that you will see if you compare it in the mind of a Syrian child living in an IDP camp is rubbles, stones, a lot of other triangles in the area. A lot of the sticks that you are seeing is them fetching water. This is the norm that they are living with every day. For them, there is no concept of what is play. This is something that we have to introduce to them. Playtime, what is it? We have to teach them how to be a child, you know? So these are a little bit on what we do when we do all of this psychosocial support. Because I think this is what is needed, because you always have a portion of these people that will develop all this post-traumatic stress, but majority of what you will need are a lot of these psychosocial skills, psychosocial educations. Yeah. So just adjusting to the norms.
When we talk about kids, though, you know, we're not also just talking about one trauma, and I think that's important for people to be aware of. They weren't just displaced once. They didn't... many of them see one act of violence. We're talking about compounded traumas.
Yeah, and this is why you always have to always teach them what is that is normal, because you have to understand that all of these children are on guards. Their life is always like, I have to be ready, or I have to be the touch. How do you make that bond, you know? Because they've lost so much. So it's a little bit, it's very difficult, you know, to go through all of these sessions, what we call them, this play therapy group, this, you know, group sessions. It's not easy. Yes, but yeah, we have a bit of the system, yeah, in place.
This conversation just reminded me of a 13-year-old girl who I met on my last trip into Syria. So she's 13, obviously. War started when she was 3. Her father had disappeared, detained. She had lost her leg in a bombing. And I asked her, you know, did she dream of a life without war? And she kind of looked at me blankly. And then I said, can you imagine a life without war? And she shook her head. And to me, it just spoke volumes that she couldn't even imagine or dream of a life without war because she literally had no clue what that looked like. And I mean, this is such an ongoing and unpredictable conflict. And I want to ask this question to all of you, and it's a tough one, it's a broad one, but you know, what does the future hold? You can't even say how do people begin to rebuild their lives after 10 years of war, because for so many of them, their life is just so uncertain. But you know, what comes next for MSF and the others providing healthcare and support? And Joel, I'll start with you on this one.
Glad to be me on this tough question. Honestly, I don't know what's going to happen. And even after working all these years, you know, with several colleagues, we always said that when a big event happened in Syria, like a big displacement, a big massacre or something, we always said it cannot get any worse. And the reality is that each year it was getting worse. So now when you ask me this after 6-7 years, I don't know. I really don't know. But what I know is that independently of what happens and independently of what might happen, whether it's worse or not, is for me to, and for not just me and MSF and the rest of our colleagues, but also for others to continue doing what we are doing, because this keeps hope alive. I have spoken with several doctors right after their hospital was bombed, the ones who survived. And honestly, I still cannot understand it even today. We were more dwelling on it than they were. They were focusing on like, okay, we found another place actually. We're gonna set up here and we're gonna set up there. And I was speechless. I didn't know what to say. I was trying to see, okay, what happened? If who's safe, who needs something? And they were already focusing on, okay, how can we resume the service? The ones who survived this attack, how can we resume and give again and continue to give and continue, if you will. This is me. I mean, I call it a kind of human resistance. It's this humanity that allows you to resist and to continue throughout all of this. And we have seen it. I have seen it. And I think that it doesn't just belong to them or to me. And I think it's all of us who took part in this in any way we did, whether it's from afar with a post, with a donation, with talking to someone. Everything in this counts, and this solidarity has to be claimed by all of us and continued. And hopefully, with that in mind, and if that continues, then maybe we have a brighter future. But then again, I continue that, but at the same time, I don't dare to hope. You know. That's maybe my defense on this question. Thank you.
Arla, your thoughts?
I think this is a difficult thing to answer, and certainly one to answer with any optimism. What will happen next, I'm very sad to say, is that the health and humanitarian situation, poverty levels, and the devastation to the health system will continue to have its effect. And if the UN Security Council resolution on cross-border aid doesn't get renewed in July, there's a humanitarian catastrophe worse than anything we've seen, even with the escalation of violence at the end of 2019, early 2020 in northwest Syria, than we can possibly imagine. But what is it that we should do? So for those of us like myself who sit outside of Syria, or anyone else in the international community, we must always stand in solidarity with Syrian civilians and Syrian healthcare workers in any way that we possibly can. And that's whether with donations, whether with support in terms of education, and you know, quite simply in solidarity, because they do feel forgotten. And it's really important for us never to forget the sacrifices that they have made and continue to make, because remember, so many of them could have left, but they haven't. And you know, they work in the most unimaginable of circumstances. In terms of the health and humanitarian sector, remember, this is a vastly underfunded response. So all of us must do everything we can. I'm always surprised because people say Syria's out of the news. For me, it's never out of the news, but I can understand why with the trends in PrEP. So, you know, people like yourself, Arwa, who do brilliant work highlighting the needs. We mustn't just go on to the next humanitarian disaster. We must always be highlighting the situation in the northeast, in the northwest, even now in government-controlled areas, because the humanitarian situation is dire. And we must continue to allow health and humanitarian aid to be provided by humanitarian organisations. I won't go into the politics of it, but it's needless to say that it's a politicised situation where many humanitarian organisations that do excellent work cannot register in government-controlled areas. So if they start to lose access in areas outside of government control, that's going to be devastating for the people who remain in those areas.
Well,
yeah, I think there's been a lot of pertinent points made. I think the Syrian conflict is so hard to predict and has been so hard to predict. It's been a proxy war. There's been geopolitical players involved, which make it so hard to know how things will go in the future. But those states, the US, Russia, the government of Syria, Iran, etc., they have a responsibility to ensure that services and healthcare are provided. And let's not forget that, for example, in the Northeast, that the area, the Kurdish authorities are supported by the coalition, which is predominantly made up of the US. And there has been significant destruction in the Northeast of facilities as a result of coalition bombing. And there needs to be huge investment to rebuild cities such as Raqqa, such as the region of Deir ez-Zor, to allow people to rebuild their lives. And that takes a commitment of resources and funding in order to be able to do that. And that's going to be so important, that humanitarian assistance for the short term, for more immediate needs, is provided from the international community, from international organizations such as MSF, but also medium and longer term. Syria will need to rebuild, and that's going to take a long time, and that needs a commitment of the international community. The Syrians have shown remarkable resilience to go through a decade of war, but it is so important that we stand shoulder to shoulder, that we also as MSF continue to do whatever we can to support them, and as Aula said, to make sure that we share the plight, share the stories, give the voice to Syrians, to make sure that, you know, the world doesn't forget, and we don't risk that the Syria conflict becomes that we become fatigued, and we need to keep the plight of Syrians on the map and show our support to them.
Thank you. And Dr. Chen, your thoughts?
I mean, I think a lot has been said about, you know, what it is. For me, it's just, I just want to say one thing. If the people of Syria doesn't give hope, and I hope the international community and us don't give up our hope for them also. So let's continue to support them. And I think this is just the message that I wanted to give, because I think all the panelists give a lot of their views about, you know, the humanitarian needs and all of these things. So thanks.
Yeah, and just to add on to everything that you've all been saying, I think the stories that you're sharing about how you yourselves, how everyone who you know on the ground is still fighting, even if they're fighting every day,
what do I do
for survival? They're still fighting, they're still struggling. And so even if this conversation can seem, you know, very thick and deep and helpless and hopeless, the important thing to realize is that it's not. And we need to keep talking about it, and we need to keep fighting for the civilian population. You know, as a journalist, we realized a long time ago that no reporting out of Syria was really going to shift the needle. And yet for those of us that keep reporting on Syria, it's because we refuse to allow global apathy to demoralize us into silence. And I think it's something that sort of extends over to the humanitarian and medical sectors as well. Just because a problem seems insurmountable does not mean that we should turn away. And the beautiful stories you hear from people on the ground, even if they're heartbreaking, are why it's so important. Because if Syrians were just given a chance, the country that they could build for themselves would be spectacular. And it's all of our responsibility to try to help them to do that. Unfortunately, that's all the time that we have. I have to say this one by very quickly. Thank you, Chen, Joelle, Will, and Arla for such a fascinating conversation. And thank you all of you for taking the time to be with us today. It's been a pleasure being your host. Apologies if we did not get to your questions, but please stay in touch. Not with me. I mean, you can, of course, but that's fine. Stay in touch, stay connected with MSF. You can email the team at event.rsvp@newyork.msf.org. For more information, you can also visit the website for the US. It's doctorswithoutborders.org, and the international site is msf.org. And you can also follow MSF on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and beyond. Goodbye, and thank you so much for joining us.